In the name of Jesus, the Christ, the Son of the living God, who is our Savior and our captain in the well-fought fight. Today we hear Jesus ask his disciples then, and you today, who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus says, I tell you, Peter, flesh and blood, your mom and dad didn't reveal this to you, although it's important that mom and dad teach that. My Father who is in heaven has revealed this to you. And you are Peter, and upon this rock, your confession, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. When a young person is inducted into the military, he or she takes an oath of solemn promise. And currently, that oath runs like, says something like this: I, and the name of the person, do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and that I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of officers appointed over me, according to the regulations and the Uniform Code of Military Justice, so help me God. Most of the young men and women who take that oath have some sort of vague idea what military service means. After they've been in a while, they get a different idea of that, and some know that it means putting their body in harm's way. But I wonder if they really knew what it meant when they took the oath. The Reverend Philip Brandt, who serves as a professor at Concordia University in Portland, Oregon, remembers being flabbergasted while on a tour of a Navy ship, a destroyer, that he learned that the young man who was steering the thing was a mere 20 years old. He was a 20-year-old high school graduate guiding a multi-billion dollar vessel around the world. And yet, when that young man comes home, he won't even be able to rent a car until he's 25. And yet, he had been empowered with the responsibility necessary to take this vessel even in to battle. In the same way, Christ empowers us in our confession of him today as we go into battle to storm the gates of hell. Most of us would be happy if Jesus would just help us a little bit with our pet sins or give us a little bit more money so we can put something in the offering plate for the benefit of his church. But that's not where Jesus ends. Jesus is not satisfied with that. He hears the promises made in baptism. Not that animal, rather two, right? And in confirmation, which is a affirmation of the vow at baptism. He empowers us every time we confess our faith, as we did when we confessed the Apostles' Creed, in order for us, as his soldiers, to storm the gates of hell and win. On this rock of the confession, Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Not even hell's gates can withstand the onslaught. On this rock, this confession that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, Peter would storm the gates of hell. Peter makes a great confession. And he gets it right, Peter, when Jesus asks him, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus delights in his words of confession. And he even says, I'm going to build my church on that confession. However, if we keep reading in Matthew, as we will next week, Peter does not do so well with this. Just a few verses later, Jesus calls Peter, get behind me, Satan. Jesus knows this, but our Lord still delights in the confession of St. Peter in verse 17. Jesus knows all, and he knows soon that Peter will try to steer him away from the cross to which he is focused. But that doesn't take away the reality of the good words of Peter right now. Peter does get it right in this moment, and God delights in it. And even though later on Peter will do far worse, Jesus will use St. Peter for huge things. Oh, you know all the rest of Peter's story. Jesus is on trial, right? What's Peter doing out in the courtyard? He denies his Lord 3 times. And he watches them strip him and scourge him and torture him and put him on a cross to die. But that's hardly the end. Because Easter morning, Jesus tells the women at the grave, at the tomb, "Tell my disciples and Peter that I'm going ahead of them to Galilee." And there in Galilee, Jesus forgives Peter. And then he says, he reinstates Peter. "Peter, do you love me more than these? Feed my sheep." "Do you love me more than these?" Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." "Feed my lambs." "Do you love me more than these?" Peter says, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus says, "Tend my flock." Peter will go on to be a spirit-filled, bold witness for Jesus. And on the rock of his original confession, "Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God," the Lord would build his kingdom, and hell would have no power over it. On that same rock, "Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God," you and I will storm the gates of hell. As with Peter, Jesus delights in our confessions too. We too make a promise and a confession of Christ on the day of our baptism and again on our confirmation. And we got it right. We confessed Jesus with the true and sturdy words of the Apostles' Creed as we did in the baptismal rite. And God loved to hear those promises. He delights in the words of that day. And he still does. And Jesus restores us whenever we deny that confession. Those of you taking sermon notes, here is the law. Like Peter, we have not always lived up to those promises that we have made. We have fled the embarrassment of being a Christian when it regards danger to our career or risk to our popularity. But Peter, like him, Christ has sought us out and restored our relationship with him. Here is the gospel. Christ has poured out his Holy Spirit on us, so that we believe that Jesus came to this earth to restore that relationship. That Jesus, the Christ, lived a faultless life, and then by faith gives us that faultlessness, represented in the baptismal blanket. Alan now wears the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Jesus, the Christ, permitted his creation to torture and nail him to the cross, where he died in order to forgive all our sins and to defeat the power of the devil. 3 days later, he victoriously rose from the grave, conquering death. And he ascended into heaven with the promise that he's coming back to take us to be with him forever in eternal life. And until we go to heaven, he pours out his Holy Spirit on us, so that we are empowered to storm the gates of hell. He has said this whenever we forgive someone. You see, the devil doesn't want you to forgive people. He'd just as soon have you hold grudges. To forgive means you are operating under the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus Christ. And God backs up those words when you say, "I forgive you." And the gates of hell cannot prevail against them. So here's what's expected of us. Sin has trapped our neighbors and sometimes even us. Our neighbors are hellbound in their sins. And they are bound by Satan's cruel chains. You and I, under the power of his gospel, are empowered to break those chains. The sweet words of forgiveness that we may speak in Christ are the very stuff of heaven. Hell must yield before them, and the prisoners of sin and death are set free. However, you and I become foolish if we ever think we can take on the devil by ourselves, because then he's got us right where he wants us. You cannot go into battle on your own. You should never do that. But in the power of the Holy Spirit, with the confession of faith we have been given, you and I will storm the gates of hell, and in the power of Jesus Christ, we will win. Like those soldiers who took an oath of induction, we probably stood before an altar like this, or one just like it. And do you remember your confirmation vow? Can I see the hands of all who are confirmed? Your confirmation vow was, I will suffer all, even death, rather than fall away. And God delighted in that confession. We made that solemn promise that at that time we barely understood, but God did. And he loved to hear what we said, and he's promised now to use us, even though, like Peter so long ago, we are a flawed, simple people. God has put into our mouths these words. Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the rock on which his church is built. These are the words we speak in Christ's name and in Christ's power. They are hammer blows to crush Satan's power as we, the soldiers of the cross, are empowered now to storm the gates of hell. So, everyone, please understand this as I mean it. It's time to go to hell. To take on Satan with the power of Jesus Christ, forgiving the sins of those who don't yet know him as their Savior, but through us being able to crash down those gates and in the power of the Holy Spirit bring those to saving faith so they too can spend eternity in heaven. It's time to be storming the gates of hell, because Jesus is the Son of the living God. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will keep your hearts and your minds in the love of Christ until the day you see him face to face in heaven.